along with us as we celebrate this retreat. Thank you for being with us. Just a couple of announcements as we head to our week. Remember that Sunday school, if you have kids Sunday school age, confirmation age, Sunday school starts, Rally Sunday is September 10th. Also on September 10th, since you are all here at this service, you're the ones that need the next announcement because the 10 o'clock worship now moves back to 10:30 on September 10th. Not next week, September 10th. We go back to 10:30. So keep that in the back of your mind. Prayer concerns as we head into our week. We want to keep Tom Niemeyer in our prayers. Tom continues to be hospitalized, so we will keep him in our prayers. We want to keep Dale Anderson in our prayers. Dale is rehospitalized, so we will keep him in our prayers. And then a friend of Amy's, Steve, was in a motorcycle accident yesterday and is hospitalized. We will keep him in our prayers as well. We also want to continue to keep the family Richie Storn in our prayers. Richie's funeral was Thursday. And also the family of Laverne's funeral was Friday. So we keep those families in our prayers as they grieve the loss of loved ones. When we get to communion, we'll give you the instructions for that because that'll be a little different this morning. But I'll tell you closer to the time so that you remember what you're doing. Thank you to the band for leading us this morning. And the choir will be singing, so lots of music and fun energy this morning. So thank you for being here as we worship. Let us take a moment to prepare our hearts, and we will begin worship. As you're comfortable, if you're able, don't feel you have to, but if you're comfortable, please stand and please sing hymn number 576 in your bulletin.
Thank you.
age. We praise you, the rock of our life. Be our strong foundation and form us into the body of your Son, that we may gladly minister to all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Never be ended. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
to invite the children up front for the children's message. Come on up. And I need to let you know that there is no way that I'm sitting on concrete. So I'm grabbing a chair, and I invite you to do the same. Let's put some chairs up here, okay? Ah, that's a lot better than sitting on the hard concrete, isn't it? So did you enjoy the hot weather this week? Yeah, did you? Yes, no, maybe, kind of, You know what I started thinking about in the midst of all the hot weather we've had? Snow. Yes, snow. I've been thinking about snow. I've been thinking about how nice it would be to go outside and play in the snow and not be like 99 degrees and just sweating all over the place. And then I remembered something. About 4 years ago, I hurt my wrist, and I couldn't shovel snow. And we had snow one day, and we had a meeting. The congregation council was coming to our house that night, and I had to clear the driveway, and my wrist was all bandaged up because I had really sprained my wrist badly. Now, driving home from La Crosse thinking, what am I going to do? I don't think Pastor Teen is going to be much help. So I got home, and when I got to my house, my driveway was all clear. Like a miracle. And I went in the house, and I was ready to thank Pastor Jean, and she said, I didn't do it. Some kids down the street came by and said, we'll shovel your driveway. And they didn't even know that my wrist was all banged up. And I wondered who they were. I didn't know who they were. Well then, now we're going to skip ahead to, remember we had the really bad storm about a month ago? And one of our trees, part of our tree came down, and Dean Olson over here, he came over and he helped me chop up the tree. And while we were chopping up the tree, those same kids came down and helped us. Like, who are you guys? Well, you know, there's a question. I'm going to read a gospel reading, Jesus and his disciples. And Jesus says to his disciples, who do people think that I am? And they have different answers. And then Peter says, you are God's son. Well, you know, those people who were helping me, it wasn't God's son. But they were the presence of Jesus for me at that moment. Because remember what I said? My wrist was all banged up and I couldn't, like, do much snow removal, but they were there for me. And then they were there when we were trying to clean up from the storm. And I was thinking about that. Maybe that's what it means for us. I mean, if someone says, who was that? Well, I'm not Jesus. But in a sense, I can be like Jesus, can't I? When I help somebody, like when somebody needs some help, like maybe you're outside, it's a real breezy, windy day, and you're outside, and your neighbor's garbage can is rolling down the street, and they're running after their garbage can, and you help them catch their garbage can and bring it back to their house. Or maybe it's someone who does get banged up, and they can't do much snow shoveling, but you go over to their house, and you help them with a little bit of snow shoveling. There are all sorts of ways that we can be like Jesus. And maybe someone will say, who was that kid who came over and helped me? I don't know. But it's kind of like Jesus, wasn't he? And so I want you to think about maybe this week you can look for chances to be like Jesus so that when someone says, who was that? They can say, I don't know. I think she's one of those Schulkes kids, but I don't know. She's kind of like Jesus, wasn't she? Or he was kind of like Jesus, even if his name is Weston. He's like Jesus. So think about that. Maybe you can find some ways this week to be like Jesus, okay? All right, thank you very much. Go back to your seats. And as they are doing that, as you are comfortable, would you please stand as you're comfortable as we sing the gospel affirmation.
Oh,
Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. So the gospel reading this morning is sort of two pieces. And the second piece is kind of those odd words at the end where Jesus says, "I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven, and bound in earth is bound in heaven," and so on. It's a theological concept we call the office of the keys. And what's interesting for us this morning is that that same concept is repeated in almost the same words in 2 weeks. In Matthew 18, we'll hear that reading in 2 weeks. And it just so happens that I'm scheduled to preach that week, so I'm going to deal with that then. So if you're kind of wondering about this power of the keys stuff, there's your tease. You need to come in 2 weeks and find out. But in the meantime, I want to talk about the first part of the reading, where Jesus and his disciples talk about identity and about allegiance. But first, I want to make a plug here for Bible study. We have a Bible study on Wednesday mornings. We meet at 9:30 and we talk for about a half an hour. And then we get into the meat of the matter and we run until about 11 o'clock. We have a really wonderful time. You are always, 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 always welcome to join us. I do want to make a plug for a second Bible study. It's in the newsletter, the September newsletter. The La Crosse Area Synod has, working with Pastor Len Liptak out of Black Hammer, Minnesota, has produced a series of videos on how we approach Scripture. How do we read Scripture? How do we read the Bible? And what they're inviting congregations to do is to gather groups of people over three sessions to watch the video and talk about them. And then they're inviting us, inviting us to then join with other people from other congregations in October to kind of talk about what we learned. So what we're gonna do is on the last three Thursdays of September in the evening, 6:30 to about 8 o'clock, we're gonna watch some videos and talk about them. And then on the first Thursday of October is the opportunity to gather in our Redeemer with people from other congregations. So it's three sessions here, one in La Crosse. You don't have to go to that one, but you can just do the three here. So I'm just throwing that out there. That's an opportunity coming up in September into October. I share all that because one of the things that I always stress with Bible study is that when we read a text, we look for things that may be seen either out of place or somewhat remarkable. For example, a couple weeks ago we had the reading of Jesus interacting with a Canaanite woman. Matthew makes a point of telling us she is a Canaanite. He doesn't tell us what she's wearing. He doesn't tell us what the weather was like that day. That's not important. But Canaanite was important. And it's kind of a clue that he mentions it. There must be some reason why he told us that. The same thing happens in the reading that we have in front of us, though in maybe a little different way. The story of Jesus asking his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" appears here in the Gospel of Matthew, but it also appears in the Gospel of Mark. And for the most part, the two stories are the same, with one little difference. In the Gospel of Mark, Jesus is on his way, journeying to get to Caesarea Philippi. In the Gospel of Matthew, he's already there. When they got to Caesarea Philippi, he asked the question. Now, so what's the difference? Well, scholars think that part of the difference is that in the Gospel of Mark, to say that you are on the way is code language for living a life of discipleship. And so the question has to do with how we live our lives as disciples of Jesus. In the Gospel of Matthew, we are already in Caesarea Philippi. And so one observation that I came across that I really appreciate is the idea that in Matthew, the place is important. You know, a lot of times we say, it's not the destination, it's the journey that matters, right? You all heard people say that. This is the other way around. It's not the journey in Matthew, it's where we are, Caesarea Philippi. Okay, so why is that so important? Okay, so Caesarea Philippi was a town or city about 25 to 30 miles north of the Sea of Galilee. And that places it in the headwaters of the Jordan River. And one of the features of that area is that there are a number of caves with springs of water, and the water then becomes the Jordan River. One of those caves in ancient times was dedicated as a shrine to one of the Greek gods. And on the inside of the cave are inscriptions in Greek that refer to some of the other gods in the Greek world. This was a place of theological importance for Greek gods, but not for Jesus and for God, our God. Moreover, Caesarea Philippi was established in a crossroads of trade routes. This was a place of economic significance. It was a place of economic power. Money spoke volumes in Caesarea Philippi. It was also the administrative center for that region. It had political power. And for the people reading Matthew's gospel, Matthew wrote his gospel probably 80 years after Jesus was born, 80 years after Christmas, so the year 80 AD. In the year 70 AD, the Jewish people revolted against Rome, and Roman legions destroyed the temple, demolished the temple. And when they finished demolishing the temple, they went back to their base, which was in, what do you think? Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi was a place of military power, of political power, of economic power, and a place where there were shrines dedicated to the Greek gods. And it is there that Jesus poses a question to his disciples. Who do people say that I am? Some people say he's John the Baptist, who earlier in the gospel lost his head. Some people say he's Jeremiah, who died, 500-600 years ago. And some people say you're one of the prophets. They're all dead people. And then Peter speaks for the disciples when Jesus asks the question, who do you say that I am? He responds, you are the Messiah, the Son of the, what kind of God? Living God. Not a dead prophet from the past. The Son of the living God. Now, at first glance, it might seem to be that this is about identity. I would argue it's not about identity. It's about allegiance. Who to whom is your allegiance? Remember where we are in Caesarea Philippi. We are in a place where there is theological significance, but it's those other gods. We are in a place where there is economic power at play and political power at play and military force is present. Where is your allegiance? The disciples proclaim it is in Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. The Messiah, the Son of the living God. So that word Messiah is an interesting word. It's a Hebrew word, and it means the anointed one. So in the Old Testament into the New Testament world, they were looking for the Messiah, the promise of the Messiah, the one who is anointed by God to be God's agent of change in the world. Now, just as a little aside, we all know Jesus Christ, right? You need to know that Christ is not Jesus' last name. He was not the child of Mary and Joseph Christ, okay? Christ is the Greek version of Messiah. So when we say Jesus Christ, what we're really saying is Jesus, the anointed one. Jesus, the chosen one. Jesus, the agent of God's work in the midst of a really crazy, messed up world. Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. In the face of all those other demands, or all those other possibilities, all those other gods, or economic stuff, you know, the power of money, political power, the power to get people to do what you want them to do, or military power, the power to with them if they don't do what you want to do. In the midst of all those demands or all those possibilities for allegiance, the disciples proclaim, you are the agent of God's work in the midst of a messed up world. Which makes some sense. I mean, it makes a lot of sense, of course, but it makes some sense, especially in the flow of the Gospel of Matthew. Because all the way at the beginning of the Gospel of Matthew, all the way in the very first chapter of Matthew, I'm going back to my snow theme here, because it's a Christmas text, okay? Remember the story, Mary and Joseph, right? Mary's a virgin, she becomes pregnant, but they're not married yet. And Joseph decides to divorce her quietly, because he could have her stolen, but he decides to divorce her quietly. And instead, an angel comes to him and says, don't do that, because this child is of the Holy Spirit, and you shall name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. That's the mission of Jesus. That's the mission already in Matthew 1, which will come to fruition when we get to the end of the gospel, and Jesus hangs on the cross and then rises again. The disciples are proclaiming their allegiance to Jesus the Messiah, the one who is here to make the difference of life in the midst of a challenging life. The Jesus who will act in the cross and the empty tomb, not with the dollars, not with the political power, not with military might. Jesus who will sacrifice in order to bring life and life in abundance. Same gift, same message, shared with us. Because we live in the same kind of a world. We live in a world where money talks, don't we? And we live in a world where politics, and I'm not knocking, I was a political science major in college, I'm kind of into political stuff, but it's not about politics being wrong, it's about when I decide that politics is my salvation, that somehow being political, because being political, if you're the political leader, you get what you want, that somehow getting what I want, making sure you do what I want you to do, gives me the fullness and abundance of life. Where's Jesus in that? Where's God in that? Or the military might. The possibility that if you don't do what I want, politically, I'll make sure you do it militarily, right? You know, I'll just kind of knock you around a little bit, get what I want. That somehow we live in this world in which might makes right and money does everything and you gotta climb up the ladder of status and symbol. Where's our allegiance? The call is to have allegiance to Jesus, the Messiah. Jesus, the Son of the living God. Jesus, the one who in his death and his resurrection brings us life. Brings us life abundant and gives us a hope for a future that sometimes seems to be fleeting. Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of the Living One. So I guess there's a little identity in that too. I mean, that is who Jesus is. But even more than just saying, I know who Jesus is, it's saying, that's where my allegiance is. I am a disciple of Jesus. I will follow Jesus. Because I know that in the end, Jesus is where life and life abundant is found. Amen. We continue with singing hymn number 674, which is in your bulletin there. Let us count some tongues and pray. If you're comfortable, would you please pass?
Remind us that from the beginning of creation, you knit together a world meant for harmony. Protect and restore the wasted places to joy and gladness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Stir the leaders of nations and towns, militaries and courts, to respond to your teachings. Let your call for justice reach all people and bring deliverance where there is oppression. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Show your steadfast love and faithfulness to those in despair. Increase their strength. Care for all who feel low. Keep safe any in the midst of trouble. And protect vulnerable people from harm. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Encourage those who offer their gifts and talents in service to your church. Energize this congregation's rostered and lay leaders, musicians, teachers, greeters, and administrators, so they may be transformed in sharing your grace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Walk those who are most vulnerable and look to you for strength and hope. Be with Tom and Dale and Steve, Surround them with knowledgeable and compassionate healthcare providers who direct their care. Fill them with peace during these days of uncertainty and restore them to wholeness. Be with their families who walk this journey with them. Surround them with your love and strength. Be with Richie's family and Laverne's family as they continue to grieve their loss. Fill them with peace, confident Richie and Laverne now rest in the arms of the resurrected Jesus. We give you thanks for all who celebrate anniversaries, and especially today we give you thanks for Bill and Dory as they celebrate 50 years. Continue to walk with them and be a presence in their lives. May they feel your love surrounding them every day. Hear us, O God. God of all the saints, death is overcome in Christ's resurrection. We rejoice with the faithful departed. Sustain us in hope until we come at last to our heavenly home. Hear us, O God. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.
You may be seated. This would normally be a Hungry Jar mission moment. Hungry Jar is not present. I do need to tell you that miraculous things happen. Last night we had no children in worship. There was no money brought up, and this morning there was money in the Hungry Jar. So then I mentioned that at the 8 o'clock service, and three big kids got up. They were like, what, 50, 55, maybe 60, maybe second, third childhood, I don't know. So the Hungry Jar didn't work today anyway. But I do want to share with you very briefly a mission moment, as we do every week. If you've ever wondered, you know, where pastors come from, you cannot get them from Amazon. You cannot even get them with Amazon Prime. I mean, you know, they make a big deal about Amazon Prime, but big deal, you can't get one from a pastor. Pastors come from seminaries, and that makes seminaries special places. While not all seminary students will go on to be pastors, most will follow that route. Seminary training is academic, practical, and pastoral. But most of all, seminaries are places where disciples of Jesus are molded and shaped to be faithful to their calling as ordained leaders in the church. Seminaries train pastors to be theologians, teachers, counselors, leaders, and administrators, among other things. It's an intense journey. There's lots of learning and lots of growing to happen. Most of all, however, for Lutherans, the task of the pastor and the teaching task of the seminary is to proclaim the word and administer the sacraments. The ELCA has seven seminaries, including Wartburg in Dubuque, Iowa, Pastor Gene's school, the Lutheran School of Theology in Chicago, where I study, and Luther Seminary in St. Paul, Minnesota. Most students spend 3 years in classroom work studying the Bible, theology, church history, and learning ministry skills. They also spend a year on internship and participate in a 3-month chaplaincy program. And they work on discerning their calling and developing their leadership skills. Our Savior supports seminaries through our mission support to the La Crosse Area Synod, and then through the Synod to the ELCA. And that's important because it is very possible that at this very moment, a student is preparing to enter seminary or is going back for the next school year, who will someday be the pastor of this congregation. We don't know. But at some point, that will happen. And so, you know, our support of the mission support, our support of mission support, our support of the seminaries is, in a sense, an investment in our future. So thank you for your support of this congregation, which allows us to be supportive of the Synod and the ELCA, and in that way to be supportive of our seminaries and of those who will someday be leading a worship service like this, quite likely in a place right here. Kind of cool. So thank you for your support.
As you are comfortable, would you please rise for the great blessing? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed our right, our duty, and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, you our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again.
Please join me in the prayer our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All people are called to Christ's table. Come, eat what is good. Okay, so you can be seated while I'm giving the directions. This morning we are going to use the procedure known as intinction. You will receive a wafer, and you will dip the wafer into the wine, and in that way receive the bread and body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So we will have two stations. One station, my station over here, Jeff will have grape juice. If you want the grape juice, please come to my side, and then we'll have the grape juice. We also have gluten-free wafers at both stations. So if you need gluten-free wafers, let us know. If you need grape juice, come on my side. As we're partaking in communion, we'll sing the Lamb of God, and then also one bread, one body. For those of you who are guests and visitors, please note the communion invitation in the bulletin. We do sincerely invite you to join with us. Come, for all is ready.
Thank you.
As you are comfortable, would you rise and we'll pray with me. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you now and to the end of the age.
Amen.
The closing hymn is, What a Fellowship, What a Joy to Be. Go in peace, share the harvest.
Thanks be to God.